So, I suppose we could start. This is a bluff, so if you have any questions, ask, just interrupt me, and if you have suggestions, tell me, and tell me the goals. There are, sometimes it's just like, you don't realize something that's green up in you. Just before I start talking about the library itself, I should note that it's renamed from LibAb Front to LibEd because, well, it started out as an alternative interface to Apt, but there has been lots of new stuff since then, so the name is not appropriate anymore. Enrico says I should introduce myself, so I'm Peter. From IRC you may know me as Marfo. This is Enrico, you know him. And he will be helping me out. If you probably haven't seen the library from the inside, but if you did, you should not be scared of it anyway. The interface you will be using if you use the library should be pretty easy, well, compared to the implementation itself. You shouldn't have to need anything about the implementation to successfully use it, and you will just use a configuration of the library. I will get to that later what the configuration is, but basically it means that you get just ready classes, you just use them. And you don't worry about much else. And if you don't like C++, which many people probably don't, or just don't want to use it because it's heavy and they think the type safety gets in the way, you can use Ruby or Python bindings, which are, well, right now they are not complete, but they are getting there, and I think I have made a lot of progress during that point with that. So they actually can be used to write useful code. So about motivation, why? What is LibEd good from? Good for? Well, if you need to write a package database, you want to list stuff that's installed on the client machine, you want to write software that does something with that database. Or maybe if you want to write some sort of web interface on the server, it could be as well, because it's not necessary to have that's the same cache that Apt uses anymore, so that's abstracted. So you can use it on the server as well. This could be the first part to be done with LibApt package library, but if you need some other stuff like the tags or the desktop files, I will talk about it later, you will probably like LibApt more because you get directly what you need here. Right now there's dev tags access and the app install data. That's a package with desktop files for each application. If you know desktop standard, it's the stuff that makes up the desktop menu, like GNOME applications or KDK menu, and it has a package name for each application in the desktop file, and you can get fancy stuff from that, like application installer, like that, and maybe some other data translations of the descriptions. Right now, I don't think you can do that right now with translation project, that existing translation project. In the future, you should be able to get popcorn data, screenshots maybe, change logs. That depends on the other effort that is about collecting metadata in Debian. There was some talk about adopted some time ago.
Yeah.
And you can use libept if you want to manipulate packages that are installed on the system. If you want to install, upgrade stuff, about anything that you can do. What it can do today? Right now there is package access. For each package you can get list of available versions. For each version you can get relations like dependencies, recommends, suggests, and stuff like that. You can get conflicts, of course. For each package or version respectively, you can get most of the data that's available for it in the app database, like name for versions, version string, name of maintainer, installation status, if it's upgradable on the current system, like that. I think I'll hand over to Enrico for a bit because there's something about that.
Yeah, I maintained it at the start of Libept, and so you can, what you can do is get the categories for a package, or get all the packages that have a specific category, get related packages that are similar to one another one, and I try to implement all the same operations with categories that I can think of. And you can also access the library vocabulary, getting descriptions for long, short descriptions for all of these. And so to the right, you can see an example of a Ruby script that, in basically one line, given a category, it looks it up in the vocabulary, gets a category object, and gets all the packages with that category and put in their name if they are installed. Or if they are not installed.
Arguably in Ruby you can do basically much everything in one line.
Yes. but the nice thing is that, well, I don't know how to get that functionality which is external to Ruby so compactly. So it gets fairly trivial to make a script that shows all the arcade games you have installed in the system. These sort of cute things. So you can actually merge things together and synchronize. Toys are a game called Count Toys.
Not this?
Yes.
Oh.
You don't have XLP installed.
I don't have actually much anything installed yet. I will have to fix that after the ball.
You need XLP.
I mentioned the desktop files. I can probably show an application of that. Hopefully.
Is it starting? Please wait.
Yes.
Okay.
quickly. Okay, so this thing uses a pitch text on the suite, so I could use GNOME, and the list on the left reflects the KD menu structure. There is an GNOME equivalent as well, but written with the Python GPK, I think. That's using a different library, but I think you can just have to give it. Okay, and this whole app is using libev, well, all the version of it right now, because it's a bit broken with the current version. You just check box and say apply changes and it installs the package. For install packages, the other way around, you can check the box and so that's one of the applications.
So where does it get its data from?
It's from desktop files.
And where do you get the desktop files?
Desktop files are right now. There is no Debian package for that. It's in Ubuntu, and Ubuntu gets it from build this. They have changed it to extract all desktop files when building. I think Rafael Herzog and some other people, me included, want to do something similar but done differently for Debian to provide the metadata, not only desktop files but other stuff as well, and provide it both as package and online to get via mechanism similar to update. So I hope it will be going to Debian quite soon.
So now it's a package with the desktop files that you
install
yourself in your system?
Yes, the Ubuntu package. You can download it from Ubuntu and just install it. It has no dependencies and it works for cases. So, if you want to play with that, it's good to set up for now. Libev can as well do things like upgrade or distant upgrade on the cache. So, you can compute the transaction and you then actually can download the packages it requires to complete and do the commit. It uses the debug package to do that right now, so the depackage interface is the same. It can do update because right now this functionality in apt itself is done in the command line part of the utility, so if you write the front end, you will have to re-implement it, and well, it won't because that has it. You can do filtering, and I'll do this.
The computation of the upgrades, is it done in libapt or libapt?
Right now, the interface is in libapt. There is a new API for it, but it right now uses libapt as backend. I will eventually probably implement a different algorithm for that because maybe more of them. Right now there is one inaptitude that's not in libapt package because I don't know. I think Daniel Burrows wanted to do that as a bounty, but it was not accepted or something, so it's not done yet, and I don't know if he will do it. If he won't, I will do it in the depth. Because I can reconfigure the library, and at compile time I can change the algorithm, and probably at runtime as well, but probably doesn't make as much sense. I wanted to show the filters.
One question before you go on this. I have a little fear on this, mainly because I'm not following closely the explanation. But if you are implementing part of the functionality that also exists in apt,
yes.
Yet, don't you fear it may at some point diverge and have two incompatible tools?
Diverge. Well,
example, if you add some capabilities to one of the, I mean, of course, this is made to extend what apt currently does, but if in the process of extending it, there's some behavior change, well, it may affect the users because, well, some users are still using deselect or aptitude or
yes,
command line or whatever.
Well, you get the same thing with aptitude. It's having functionality and it does not seem to be a real problem. If you have reasonable backward compatibility, which I will have, because I want to have it work alongside apt really well, I don't see there will be a problem.
Yes.
The code base, there is not a problem with code base because that might diverge a lot. I mean, there are probably already quite some parts that are redundant from private package, but well, there is
so as long as it's the same criteria for you not to break apt or not to break the user's experience with, between one side and the other.
Yes. I really don't want to do that. Because I would be hurting myself,
yes.
Because okay.
Well, it's still the base installation of the system is done with apt.
Yes.
yes, but maybe as for example we changed the recommended tool to use this interface for the packages from deselect to aptitude. Well, at some point in the future, it may change to something but based on apt.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think it's important to keep this focus.
Yes, backward compatibility is important. I recognize that because there are just well, you can't ignore that if you are working on Debian.
Mm-hmm.
Just not even. For the filter stuff, all these filters are implemented with Apt. It does not quite fit the screen, but okay, there are buttons. I don't want any algorithms here. And maybe I just want to install it. Them because
Yeah, well, okay.
Yeah, that sounds good. Okay, I wanted to show the how the filters are made. So, yeah, here it's really nice, I don't know, but I will show you the filter mode. I will request to move something. It's a similar to this kind of preview changes. And this view is of course the same as previously, but a different filter. And the filter is here. It's not marked key, or if it's broken, show broken packages or the packages that will break. So basically everything with any changes is filtered in, and it's done with like this simple C++ expression. So it should not need to worry.
It's fairly elegant code actually. You just build a Boolean expression in C++ and operator on the right, and that's all the combination of the filtering that you have.
Yes. So any case probably disappointed with my notes, but I did not think that some of this managed to the last one. So okay, there are some other features in the library which are, so for now for Debian it's not essential, but I mentioned the library is configurable, so the point of that is you should probably be able to write a bunch of RPM components and use the same library, the same software on RPM systems, or you should be able to, for example, drop dev tags for platforms that have no actual dev tag data, where it is sort of useless to do all this stuff. And, well, it directly does not relate to Debian, but there are benefits to it anyway, because getting same applications to other platforms that originate on Debian is probably a good thing. So you can say, see, this is a Debian thing. It came from Debian and it's really cool. And you may want to try the full one on Debian because it's sort of pretty cool because there are no dev tags.
It's quite interesting because the library is a big collection of templates and it uses generic programming a lot. And so you have the package archive component doesn't particularly know what is the exact type of the package. And the dev text component doesn't know what is the exact type of the package archive or of the package or and so on. And so and there's a file which puts things together and says use that as a package, use that as the package archive, and the compiler brings everything together. So if you want to do RPM, you just do it. Just say use RPM instead of apt package.
And you get rid of lots of if the have RPM and if, because right now synaptic code is like written with that. Okay, there are some use cases for the library. You have seen adapt. I'm not sure if Henrik wants to show something with that text on the code. Or
I guess people have seen, if you had a look at my DevTex talks, that's the DevTex command line tool. That's written on top of the app flow.
Then the GUI utility.
Yeah,
okay.
As well. Yeah. I'm basically, in the past I had a lib DevTex library, and now I'm just doing the development inside of the app flow. Because if to have a lib DevTex library, I needed to access packages anyway. So I can just do it with that.
Okay, there is another package using libapt, a third-party one, mostly, because these other items are made by the two of us, so that's not really an indicator of usefulness of the API, because like we know it really well, but there is Benjamin has been using for some time now in this package search, and I think it was quite good input to have, because having someone different to use the API gives it a good test and tells you a lot what's the problem with it. And the refactoring in 0.4 version of libapt is partly based on feedback from Benjamin. Okay, so there are some other things that maybe in the future. Enrico has been mentioning that maybe the next that's the end of the festival is that.
Yeah, I want to maintain only one backend for accessing categories and package data. So my intention is actually to use Libet to implement the DevTag central database and tag archive.
I want to do a set of command line tools like apt-get, apt-cache and stuff like that using Libet, because first that will again give some testing to the library, and it should make possible things that are not currently possible with apt-get, because it does not link Libet, because Libet is changing quite rapidly and we can't expect apt people to adopt such a quickly changing code base, and we rely a lot on unit testing and we don't have so much real world coverage yet. So that's understandable. And I want to develop an alternative interface, command line, that would go along with ADAPT, and it should make available the features of the library that are unique to the library right now. There should be a lot more of ADAPT work, specifically there will probably be some redoing of the package manager, as in dpackage or RPM interface, because there are some limitations I have run in with the Libet package, and I would like to address that. I don't think there will be Libet package any soon, so I suppose that will still use the command line, but hopefully it will work. As for ADAPT, yeah, another thing is that right now apt-get can't update like the text data or other data. When I call apt-get update, it just downloads the packages files, packages indexes, and
yeah,
we want to do, yeah.
Since there's no unified way to do apt-get update, because it's re-implemented basically in everything that does it, there's no way to call a post-update hook to regenerate the backtext index, for example. And that sucks very hard. So I had to create a little daemon which watches changes in the apt index and rebuild the rest of the indexes we need, which sucks even harder, but at least makes things possible. At least makes it possible for me to have a fast DevTag index that I could use and crosses with the apt index at the level of internal package IDs. And Microbot knows the problem, so hopefully we'll get to it to actually create some updates. Database update feed function in the package with which can call hooks pre-update, post-update and so on, but they're not there yet, so there's this section available.
Yeah, it's called up index watcher, so if you see it in your top output, then that's it. if someone here will want to use the bet, that will be fine. If you want to contribute, of course you are welcome, because like there are never enough contributors. However, it's not as easy to contribute as the users, because the library internals right now, they are not that documented. There are usually unit tests, you can sort of used to get a grip on the code, but not always. There is little written documentation because we tried to write that, but it gets out of sync really, really quickly. And it usually, not everything in the library, but often you will need quite some C++ knowledge. So the plan is, there are some things that new contributors may want to do, like adding data source, like implement Popcorn data source, for example. That should not be as hard, actually, as working on the internals. And that should be documented, I think, and I will do that at some point. For the library itself, it's quite hard. Current development branch is this one, it's in SVN. There is a mailing list on Elliot. You can mail either us, I think, or the list if you have some remarks or questions. We are on IRC as well. You might have plot in this channel, or maybe if you ask in the BMW or something like that, I have pilot on that, I think, so I will not visit. I think that's about it for now. If anyone has questions? Oh, I wanted to show some examples. There are Python variants as well, I forgot about that. So this program, this program just lists the apt database in Python. It just shows output like apt-cache show, but for every package on the system.
It's like apt-cache database.
Yes.
But it also does. It shows all the information that libapt knows about. So potentially if we are the popcorn, then we are the popcorn header, even if it's not present in the patches, right?
Yes, and there are some examples in the back, so I think, yes, this works. This is library initialization. It's just instantiates the package manager instance, and the package manager just does all the stuff with your system, read write. If it's called as update, it calls update, that works. And upgrading with the library, which all this, you just download and then commit. Everything, if something breaks, it draws exceptions, so it's not handled here, but it's handled in a bit. And yeah, I think we'll be back soon because I agree with them. So I think that's about it. Maybe that's something else. Do you have some questions?
Yes, we have a great question.
Yes.
Well, to wrap it up, kind of summary of what happened is we cannot play with libapt package because it's too much of a base thing to actually shake it. If you start messing with libapt PKG code, you have very little freedom because you're breaking half of the daemon system. So, like in Peter Cave, the new playground, we have to experiment with new features. And the library is fairly complete, like can do everything that the libapt package does with a nice coherent API, which is also modular in a way that it can be adapted to different systems, configured to use different components. And it allows to plug in basically any sort of data sources. It's been done with that text. It's straightforward with Popcorn, which is one of my several things with the later. I'd like to have packages sortable by rank, the packages coming out of a quest. which is very useful together with that text data. It's like, show me all arcade games that I don't have installed and show me the most popular cards. That's like, makes for a really nice tool for people wanting to play. And from now on, it's like either library refactorings, which seems to be very trendy in the last years, but at least we are deleting lots of lines of code for every refactoring process, and the interface become really, really straightforward. So far it's been a really good thing, and then it's like adding functionalities that we haven't seen in that engine. And that I find it quite exciting, to be honest. Plus bindings. With the latest refactoring, we started to have bindings without using some impossible version of Swift, which exists only in the brain of the Swift maker. Upstream. Filippo and Filippo Giuncheri and Feller have been giving about a big metadata storage archive for the PM packages, which has all extra information that is not in the packages file, like screenshots, desktop files, build the failures, user rankings, user reviews, change logs, and the nice thing is that can be complemented with functionality in the debug form to actually access it whenever needed, which is another exciting thing. Now we have an application level interface to whatever people come up with. It's quite nice. Does somebody have questions? Oh, and the KDE Package Manager, and the equivalent of Ubuntu app install for Debian